Hey, drop.
What's up, my motherfucking people? Welcome back to another episode of the Low Life Podcast.
TGAF, you fucking Steve Urkel ass looking motherfuckers.
Yo, the new intro? Sick, bruh.
You like the music?
Loving it. That new intro is okay. Dope.
I gotta work on the outro next, but yeah, just dropped a new intro. This is the official start of the Low Life Podcast. I'm wearing this because I'm a little sentimental. I got the Low Life Chopper podcast on, but we're saying good night and good evening, and we're moving on to newer and better things. Bought the domain name. We got the Low Life Podcast. I'm changing all the socials and all that shit. I'm going to be porting over. Hopefully by the time this drops, I'll have the website actually moved over to the new domain, get our new email set up. So the Low Life Podcast TLP.
Love it.
That's what it is. And we are very excited because we are joined this week with Angel Claw Pinstriping out of where in Ohio are you from?
Chillicothe. Pretty southern. Just a little south of Columbus, which is right in the middle, so.
Yeah. Live what on is the name? Chillicothe?
Yeah, Chillicothe. T-H-E-E.
Is that like an Indian name or something?
Yeah.
It sounds good.
Ohio has so many wild names. I don't know if you guys are familiar. There's like Wampanoag. Like all kinds
of. Oh, really?
Names. Yeah.
That sounds Indian as fuck.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool when they keep the Indian or the Native American names for places. We got a few, like a lot of our rivers and mountains and stuff up here. They just kept the Native American names, but yeah, that's awesome. So we're stoked to get into this interview. First, we got a little light housekeeping. We got a little bit of light housekeeping with shows, sponsors, and shout outs. So we'll start with the sponsors because I always forget if I don't do it first. First up, you're going to want to go ahead and sign up for the Patreon. You're going to want to go ahead and follow Aero Manufacturing. We're going to be giving this away next week because I was fucking busy today and I didn't have time to set that shit up. But next week, we're going to be pulling this points cover with, I don't know what they call it in Canada. Is it a red maple leaf?
Something like that? Japanese maple.
Japanese maple, of course. It's an invasive species. They put it on their flag. So we're going to be pulling this. Aero Manufacturing, you're going to want to follow him because he's the future of motorcycle parts. That boy is fucking out of control. Next up, we got our boy Rodney Bump Shop Diaries. He's been on the show. Go check him out. Trademark Assassin. Go follow him and follow his podcast too. It's just bomb ass shit. Go buy one of our camp mugs. Summer's almost over. You're going to need a camp mug. You're going to go camping once this summer, right? I mean, you're not going to let the whole summer go by without going camping without one of these beautiful mugs. Go to lowlifepodcast.com, click on our link to our store, purchase one of the four options that we have for enamel camp mugs, and I'm going to send you a $5 off code. Then you can go over Bump Shop Diary and get some bomb-ass coffee.
Shoo.
Shoo. Let's move on to shows. Debbie Retreat's coming up, baby. Steve hit me up today.
Oh, shit.
Our tickets are in the mail. Oh, we will be set up at the Deadbeat Retreat August 9th through 11th. This is the 10th anniversary. It's going to be the most fun I've ever had at a motorcycle show. I already know it. Weather's going to be beautiful. They're going to solve the yellowjack problem in the Catskills. So there'll be no bugs. And There's a fucking reggae pool party. There's going to be biker games. There's going to be the custom Clash motorcycle show. You're doing something special there too, aren't you? There, Loctite.
Yeah. Yep. I wasn't ready for that. Set me on fire.
I can keep you on your toes, pal.
The Custom Clash Awards for Best Custom Fabrication. This is an award that Jerry and I will be picking. Best Fab Awards is sponsored by Deadbeat Customs, the Low Life Chopper Podcast, 812 Inc., Gnarly Magazine, Ricky Bongo's Lowbrow Customs, Steel City Blacksmithing, and what's that last one? I can't see it.
Arrow?
Maltese Machine Co. and Arrow Manufacturing. Sick. So you're getting prizes from all of these motherfucking people. Yeah. So if you're a fab guy, listen, I know the fab guys don't always get the limelight. Just get thrown in the back. You know, you swept up like the shavings. This is your time to shine. This is for fabricated parts only. So make sure you get out the Deadbeat. It's going to be so much fun.
And why not fucking ride with your boys? We have a ride going.
It's more than a ride.
We got a lot of people have responded. You know how motorcycle dudes are? And gals. They're not the most organized.
95 people have been like, I'm coming.
Yeah.
Day of ride, 17 are going to show up.
Yeah. I don't even know if I'm going to be there, and it starts at my house. But if you are down to clown, it's going to be a beautiful ride out there. It's going to start in sunny, tropical Henniker, New Hampshire. We're going to kick stands up at 10 a.m. We got a ride organized that goes up over Hogback Mountain through beautiful rural Vermont back roads. We're going to hit up the El Dorado Bar in Troy, New York. That's a secondary meetup spot. So if you're coming down from Canada or out west or somewhere in New York and you want to link up on the ride, meet us at the El Dorado Bar. Owner's super cool. There's going to be a bunch of heads there. And we're going to hang out and eat some lunch. They're going to open up early. VIP access for TLP. And it's going to be about an hour more south till we invade the Blackthorn Resort. And we're going to party your fucking asses off. I'm bringing Narcan, just in case.
Yikes. That kind of party. I don't think Narcan works with alcohol, but
I'll bring a stomach pump. Just pump my stomach. I don't know. Someone might slip me a Mickey. All right. We got shout outs.
We got one more
shout outs. Oh, shit.
The Smokeout Rally, September 5th through the 8th, Rowan County Fairgrounds, Salisbury, North Carolina. Your boy will be there. I'll be there all day Friday. I know I said Saturday before, but I fucking changed my mind. I'm going home Saturday. I'm going to be there all day Friday, sun up to sundown. They got live music, wet t-shirt contest, bike shows, mini bike racing, the Tankful Bike Art Display, World's Strongest Biker Contest, burnout contest, vendors, great food, and tons of camping. So, show the fuck up. September 5th through the 8th. I will be there on the 6th if you want to hang out.
That's what we call a cameo. You just pop it in.
Pop it in, pop it out.
So if you need if you want an autograph, you got to be quick.
Real quick.
You'll have security there, right?
Oh, yeah.
Shout outs. Do you have any shout outs?
No, I hate everybody.
Yeah, I'm gonna shout out the El Dorado Bar because this dude's been so cool about this ride. You know, they don't typically open till like 4 p.m. and I thought it was super cool that he offered to open up early and get the kitchen going and have some drinks and shit. So El Dorado Bar, if you're in the Troy area, actually a bunch of dudes hit me up that are from the Troy area, and they're like, I can't wait till you see this place. You know, they got a lot of hometown pride out there in Troy. So shout out to El Dorado Bar, super cool. I'm going to also shout out Chris from Oxford Coach Oppers, because he was able to help find a buyer for my shovel head. So I am eternally thankful for that, because as you guys all know, I need big money quick. And, you know, it's mid season. It's hard to sell a chopper. It's hard to get the kind of money that I wanted for it. And maybe I was a little bit unreasonable because I spent so much goddamn time on the fucking thing. But it got some nice parts. But he was able to secure a buyer. I'm going to be going down there tomorrow or sometime this weekend and to drop that off. And so thank you, Chris. Fucking real one. He hopped right in and helped me out. And I get to go, I think it's like 4 hours down to Oxford. So taking a long trip down there. But that'll be fun. You got some shout outs, bro. Oh, wait, you already said fuck everybody. Angel Claw, do you have any shout outs?
I'm so glad you asked, because yes, I do. At Fuel, I met the most badass group of people from New England, and they all listen to the show. Yeah. So I want to shout out Dave and Ralphie and Tommy Amia and Tim 1 and Tim 2. And I love you guys.
Hell yeah. No shit. Where are they from in New England?
Man, I don't know. They all live in the same neighborhood, though. How crazy is that? And they all have really? Badass shoppers. Yeah.
That's wild.
Hmm.
Yeah. They could start a shop if they wanted. Like, one knows how to, like, fabricate. One does the other thing. They have a page
nice.
Of friends. Yeah.
No shit. So any of you guys, if you do listen to the show, hit us up and let us know who you are. And we'd love to have you on. That's cool that New England people are making it out to Ohio. That's not a small feat. New England's far.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they came straight through. And so they were all sitting together. All their chops were together. And I went over. I think Tommy came over and introduced himself to me first. And then I went over and I shook everyone's hand. And I started shaking Tommy's hand. And then Ralphie was there. So then I had to shake Ralphie's hand.
Mm-hmm. I seen a picture.
Yeah.
I think maybe on Facebook. Of you sitting on somebody's bike.
Oh, it's Tommy. That's Tommy, yes.
Oh, okay. He was like, this chick blessed my bike or something. Yes. I was like, what the fuck? That's Angel Claw.
Yeah. Oh, my God. You asked me to pose on a bike. I'm not going to say no, okay? Like, that's my favorite thing. So, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's
They're
awesome.
They're very, very, very cool people. So, yeah.
Yeah, really what's happy. Up? So, yeah, let's get into it. I guess we definitely want to get into... Fuel Cleveland. It looked like a fucking blast.
I'm like still on cloud nine about it.
Is this your first time going?
So I went last year. Last year was the first time.
Okay.
And I heard about it at one of my local bike nights up at Smitty's Tavern. Sick Boy Pinstriping. I don't know if you guys follow him or not.
Fuck yeah, I know him.
Yeah, he's so cool.
I've known him for a while. And he's like TikTok famous, by the way.
Yeah. So I was kind of like awestruck, but I was talking to him last year and he was doing some striping down at Smitty's and he asked if I was going to Fuel. I was like, what's that? Told me. And I was like, oh, I'm definitely going. So last year I went and then just got so inspired. And that was the day I decided I wanted to build a chopper. And then this year I got to go with my fucking chopper. And so that was just... It's like unbelievable. I don't even know. I'm just so thankful.
That's awesome. So you started last year. You built a chopper with between the Fuel Clevelands that you went to.
What, I started what, in February.
In February. Oh,
and
fuck.
And I finished it last Wednesday. Yeah.
Oh, you just got finished last Wednesday. Fucking A.
Yeah.
Down to the wire. So that was your goal, to get it done by Fuel Cleveland?
I just wanted it done. Okay. This is so... fucking stupid. First thing you need to know about me is I'm kind of a ditz, so let's just establish that. When I went to Fuel, let me back up. We went to Fuel. What really set it off for me was Lowbrow had out their frames, their full frames, and I was talking to Jeff, I think, and he's like, yeah, it's super easy. You just buy a donor bike and you just swap it over. And I don't even know how to use a socket set at this point. And I'm like, yeah, I can for sure do that. It won't even take long. So get my Sportster last year, then saved up some money. January or February, we're going to Daytona in March. I was like, oh, I'm just going to do this, like, and I'll have it by Daytona for sure. Easy.
Yeah.
I just have to swap it. And so dumb looking back, but yeah, so that didn't happen. Went on a few shakedowns the past month, got trailered home a few times, but we've got it working. And hot dog, I took it to fuel.
What kind of sporty is it?
It's an Evo Sporty, 883, 92.
Okay.
Evos are my favorite motors. I love an Evo.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, same. I just picked up an Evo project and I'm super stoked on it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I got a 1200 I just picked up. I sold my Sporty. Was it this year? I think I sold my Sporty this year, my 1200.
Yeah.
But yeah, I missed it. I regretted it immediately because it was like my first build, you know, type of thing. Learned a lot on that bike. But yeah, super stoked on this one. Might even enter myself into the Born Free competition and definitely get rejected because sporties don't get into that competition. Aww. But
that would be sweet,
if I had a slab side shovel, fucking maybe I'd have a chance. But or a metric bike, or if I was good at building bikes, I might be able to get in. But actually, I had another shout out. There was some dude on YouTube, and he suggested that I do a build series on that sporty. And I think I'm going to try to do that. Yeah. Just because I think I have all the parts to put it together. So it's something I could probably like get continuity and do the filming and like just kind of bolt it together and do the fab and shit. But who's the, who's this little lady in your lap?
This is Shotzi. She is my 10-year-old lady. She's a little dachshund. She's very nosy, so if she hears a unfamiliar voice, she needs to come around. So,
dude, I can't believe I guessed the gender just from looking at the face.
You just know. She just exudes feminine, you know, energy. So.
I had a dog that I thought was a dachshund. I thought it was like a dachshund mix. His name was Disco Man 3000.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, he passed away maybe 2 years ago. But he looked exactly like a dachshund. Maybe mixed with like a corgi, you know, he had like blonde hair and he was a total wiener dog. And we got one of those DNA tests on him. And it turns out that he was a mastiff, bull terrier, chihuahua. He was like 40 different things. And we're just like, no dachshund, no corgi. And I was just like, holy shit, dude. Had that pop out, that wiener dog. But shout out to Disco Man. All dogs go to heaven. But 10 years old, I got old dogs too. I got a couple of dogs left and they're in their teens now, so they're golden
years.
That makes
me sad. That makes me so sad.
Yeah.
Man, yeah.
But my dog's only 4, I think. Aww. And I'm already so sad.
Yeah. She's Jacob's little angel, so he loves that dog more than me, I'm pretty sure.
Have you had her for 10 years, or did you get her when she was little? Oh, okay. So you got
her when she was like 4 weeks old. She was 2 pounds, and she just fit in your hand, but she was so little. Yeah.
Yeah, that's fucking
very
amazing.
And spoiled, you know, first kid, so.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I was a total dog dad for a long time. We did fostering and shit, and just dogs everywhere, and puppies are the best. You know, we had a pit bull at one point. We were in Paws, New England, and they ship dogs up from Tennessee. Mm-hmm. And we got a pit bull, and she was kind of nasty, and nobody wanted to take her, and she was pregnant. So we're like, you know, oh, well, we'll take her because we're stupid. And she had, like, fucking 10 puppies, and it was the best, like, month of my life just being in a puppy pile, dude. Just like covered in pit bull puppies.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a lot of fucking work though, because little baby dogs like shit and piss and they do not care
like
where they
puppies.
Do it. You don't like puppies?
No.
Wait, what?
You don't like puppies?
No, I think that's like I love dogs. I'm a dog person. I've grown up with dogs my entire life. But I think the puppy stage is the worst. Like,
all
right. Cash, my dog now, Cash, he's now 110-pound pit. When he was a puppy, he was a son of a bitch. First of all, I wasn't allowed to sleep in my room anymore. I had to sleep on the couch with him, or he would howl like a hound dog because he was so sad. So we found out that the guy that sold him to us told us he was 8 weeks old. We brought him to the vet. He was only 4 weeks old.
So, oh, fuck.
Yeah, we got him way too young. So he wasn't that was ready, like part yeah. of the problem. But yeah, he would just like lose his mind when I went to work. If I tried to go to bed without him, literally ate everything. Ate literally a door, ate my wall, ate my couch, ate my TV stand.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was a really tough 6 months.
Forgot about the eating stuff phase.
Yeah, the eating yeah. stuff.
Pit bulls. So here it is with pit bulls. Like when they're tiny, tiny, eight mm-hmm. weeks old, great.
Mm-hmm.
Once they hit like 4 months to a year, they're like little fucking velociraptors.
Too true.
I hate
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
After that, they're great though. I love them now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I forgot about the eating. Yeah. Cause I got Disco. He was my first like adult dog that I bought when I was an adult, not like a family dog. And I was living in Phoenix at the time and renting an apartment. And I went to a shelter and he ran up. I went there to go look actually at a boxer. But he was outside like playing and he ran up to me like super happy and he coughed up a bloody tooth because he was like, you know, 6 weeks old or something.
This one.
Yeah. And I was like, I'll take this guy. And he was super small and cute and shit. And I brought him home, but he had like super bad. I guess they picked him up on like the side of the highway, like on a road to Mexico, just like abandoned, like dead on the side of the road. And he had like super anxiety when I wasn't around and I had to go to work, you know, but I was living in an apartment. And I didn't know what to do. Dude, dogs growing up, I lived out in the country. We didn't even have a leash on my dog. We didn't have no collar or nothing, you know, like that was all foreign to me. But in Phoenix, you have to have like a leash and fucking walk them and like pick up their poop and shit. Like this was all brand new. And I'm in like my mid 20s. So I'm like fucking, I don't know what the fuck's going on, but I just left him in the apartment, go to work, come back. Dude, he ate all the linoleum in the kitchen, like ripped it all up. Dude, in like an 8 hour work shift, ripped it all up, scratched the shit out of the door, ate part of the couch. Ripping up the fucking carpet, dude. Like, he did, like, $20,000 in damage in, like, 8 hours. And I was like, this is going to be costly. Well, actually, I thought, at first, I was so poor back then, I was like, I'm never paying that back. I'm not getting my security deposit back, but nobody's ever coming in this place until after I move. So.
I'm going to open the stairs so Shanti can
oh, yeah.
a little temper tantrum.
I got, like, fucking fruit flies buzzing around me for some reason.
Oh, she's immediately back inside. She's so needy, I swear to God.
What are you sipping on now? Is that a chelada?
It's not. This is a High Noon. I would like to thank my brother's friend for coming to my birthday party and leaving it.
Oh, nice.
Because now I have it. And then up next, because that one's kind of low, out of Jacob's boot, I have White Claw. This is insulating it. Until I get to it.
Oh shit! The boot in the refrigerator. Boot. That's fucking. That's
you
smart.
Gotta, yeah. Get it, you
that's
know.
A big boot too. You could probably fit a 40 in that boot.
You know what? Yeah, I think you could.
You gotta drink it right out of the boot. Yeah. Don't even take it out of the boot. Just open it up.
This is my new koozie, actually. Yeah.
Yeah.
That one that's personalized. I got this.
Yeah. I love improvised koozies. One of my favorite actually is Dan from No Luck Paintworks. We went to a swap meet and we're drinking. It's like 8 o'clock in the morning. And what did he do? He wrapped it in bubble wrap from like someone had like bubble wrap in a fucking in a box and he just wrapped it with bubble wrap. And he was just walking around like a fucking hobo. And I was like, that's actually genius.
Nothing, yeah.
Yeah. Well, it conceals it because you're not allowed to drink these things either at these swap meets, you know. And they have cops walking around. But it just looks like you're drinking, you know, a Coca-Cola out of some bubble wrap, like a normal person.
Even better.
Yeah. Suspicious. All right. So I got to get to. So you're a sporty build.
Mm-hmm.
The tank is absolutely amazing. And so you're a pinstriper, right? So Angel Claw pinstriping. But this is a, as I understand, is a hand-painted tank that you did?
Yeah, so pinstriping, I started the account because I wanted to, like, pursue that. And then I got into it, and I didn't realize how many fucking great artists there are, you know? Like, duh, obviously. I just didn't know. So that's not my bread and butter. My bread and butter is, like, hand-painting stuff, like, graphic things, like the tank. Or I've been working on some, like, vintage fantasy, like, David Mann type stuff. Like, that's... I love that stuff, yeah.
So what are you using? What kind of paint and you... like paintbrushes and stuff do you use to hand paint a tank?
So for anything like on a vehicle or a bike, I'll use the enamel paint, like alpha enamel and stuff, just like you would when you pinstripe. And then, oh man, I run through brushes really, really fast with the enamel especially. So I have kind of a stock built up of like the Monster Sticks, the Mac Tidwell, or the Broken Pinky set. I love those two sets a lot. But with how fast I run through them, they're like $30 a set. And if I have to buy a set,
yeah, they're not cheap.
Yeah, so I've just been going to like Amazon and buying cheap little whatevers, and they're great. They're like $5 for a set. I throw it out after that project, and then I have a fresh set for the next one. But anything synthetic, really, for the graphic stuff.
See, here's the thing, too, is... I think, what's the one I got is like drag? Hold on. I got to get him because I don't want to misspeak on it. Give me 1 second. All right, I'm back. Luckily, my pinstripe studio is in the same place I record. All right, let's see what these things are called. I forget. Oh, yeah, that's I thought the word. Dragonfly. So I like these brushes, but my only problem is, and I think it's because I do more pinstriping than I do anything else. I like the non-synthetic stuff.
Yeah.
All the synthetic stuff, I feel like, has too much bounce. So, like, when I do, like, that oil... I don't know if you've seen it. That oil can I did with the rat fink on it?
Yeah. I remember that.
I did that whole thing with a Bobo brush. Because it's legit squirrel hair. And every time I try to use a synthetic one, it just has too much bounce, and I fuck it up. So, I'm like... And I can't find a set like that that's real squirrel hair. So, it sucks.
I like the swirl hair for like the actual pinstriping. My favorite brush is actually a 6-0. I don't know if you've seen me post about it. It's like the only one I use. It gives you the smallest little tiniest line. Yeah. Love that thing. Yeah, but for everything else, I just use synthetic. I don't know. I think I kind of like how it snaps back together. It holds its form.
Right.
Yeah.
So on that tank, did you do like a, did you spray down like the base coat? It's like a periwinkle blue, right? Like
it's the periwinkle epidemic. Oh my God, dude. It took me months to find that color, and I really? Still wasn't happy with it. Yeah. So periwinkle is like my favorite color, and everyone in my life is so fucking over the color periwinkle. They're tired of hearing me bitch about it, but it's so versatile. I don't know. There's a lot of different kinds of periwinkle. So I knew what I wanted. Get online. And what I ended up ordering was a 69 Fiat periwinkle. And so that worked because I was trying to go for like, you know, a 60s kind of theme on the bike. So like, that's where I'll do that. Yeah. So then I was like, I'm going to be a custom painter. Okay. Cause I have a fucking air compressor and I can do that. No. You have to have a really good setup to like be able to pull that shit off. And I blew so many fuses in my old garage, and it was 30 degrees. And so I won't do it again. I'm a rattle can girl. That's me.
Fuck yeah.
Mad respect to people who can fucking...
Oh, it's so hard. Paint shit. It's, yeah, you gotta be so patient and like Yeah. Things fuck up and it's catastrophically. You'll have to repaint the whole thing. And
it's expensive to fuck expensive. Up too. Yeah.
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 Yeah. And like little things fuck it up because you're working with chemicals, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And some of these chemicals don't work well together. And also, especially like in Ohio, doing a bike in the winter, you know, it's fucking freezing. Paint doesn't like to be cold, you know?
No.
It's not going to flow right. In compressors, like, you have to have clean air coming out, clean, dry air.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have that in my compressor. But you can. There are some good rattle can options out there, too, you know?
Yeah.
And
I've seen some good paint jobs with rattle cans. So,
yeah,
you know? What's that one company? It's not Tropical Glitz. Oh, I can't remember. They're always doing the contest, like, name this color.
Is it, like, House of Color or something?
Oh,
No.
God, I know exactly who you're talking about, too. I actually bought one of their pearls.
Oh, they let you name the color. I know what you're talking about, yeah.
Yeah. So
they're like, what should we call this color?
Yeah, they have
it's
some
candy
aerosol
something,
options.
Isn't it?
What is it?
I think it's candy something. Candy, is it Candy Man? No.
Shit.
I know exactly
Paint
what you're talking
Hucker.
About, though.
Paint Hucker. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes.
Yeah. I had to think about the label. Yeah, so they actually have some pretty sweet aerosol options coming out, so I am going to try that eventually. But yeah. That's
okay.
Me. But I started realizing I had fucked up when I was, like, screwing bolts into the frame, and the paint was just, like, falling off and chipping away, and I was like, oh.
Oh, shit, yeah.
Oops. Yeah, so.
Yeah, it needs a cure time. I did the same thing with my tank. I painted it, and then, like, the next day, I started bolting it down, and it just immediately started peeling up, and it's just like, ugh. But it is, it's not even cheaper if you're doing, like, certain kinds of paint jobs. Like, the one that I did, if you're doing, like, image transfer and candies and flake and all that stuff, it is not cheaper because you have to keep on buying these cans of fucking 2K to clear each. 2K cans are, like, $40 a whack now.
Yeah.
And you have to layer that shit on, like, everything that you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
But the periwinkle that you ended up putting on there, is that rattle can?
No, that's actually the spray can. So
that is the spray can, okay.
Yeah, the spray gun, whatever. Yeah. Love the color. Turned out good. It's orange peeled to hell, but you know what? That's kind of why I did that faux patina on there. So we're working with it. I was not about to redo it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the best part about fucking a paint job. You can just be like, yeah, I went for the patina, you know. Oh, yeah, I wanted it to peel.
Yeah.
I want it to naturally age. But in your mind, you wanted, like, the best paint job. So you lay down the fucking periwinkle. By the way, periwinkle was my jam in fucking high school. I have blue eyes. And I used to always wear periwinkle shirts because chicks would just be like, oh, my God, it brings out the color in your eyes. So periwinkle every fucking day.
You get it. It takes a special person to really vibe a periwinkle.
Oh, yeah. I didn't give a fuck. I was kind of a... I wasn't as cool as I was back then. I was a baby face. I didn't have this sweet beard that chicks absolutely dig. They were looking at my eyes. They were losing themselves in my periwinkle blue eyes. But I love the periwinkle, and it's actually... That now that you say like that vintage like Fiat fucking color, that's perfect, you know. Now the design that you did is fucking sick too. So that's like Japanese like dragon tiger shit.
Yeah. So I have loved Japanese style art since I was a kid. Like I grew up watching West Coast Chopper and like American Chopper and LA Ink and Miami Ink and stuff. And the Japanese style tattoos were always my most favorite. So I was researching, like, I don't know, just Japanese art one day on Pinterest. Do you guys use Pinterest?
No.
No.
No, we both have dicks.
Okay, listen. I know, I knew you would say that, but there's so much shit on there. You literally, for, like, chops and stuff, it's like a whole new world. So, yeah.
Actually, you know what? I'm going to take that back because I actually did buy something off Pinterest. The Wu-Tang stainless steel Wu-Tang thing that I got for my sissy bar. So I take it all back. They do have
there
some cool shit on there.
You need to start a low life Pinterest board and then you can have it going on. So Yeah, no, I was on Pinterest. All right,
Loctite,
today.
you're gonna be the admin for that, okay, bud?
Pinterest?
Yeah.
Pinterest. I don't know how well we'll do.
Can you swear on Pinterest?
Yeah, every comment is back, these dudes are weird.
People post your outfits of the day and, you know, whatever.
I actually don't even know what they
do,
right?
Hey, guys,
right?
Today I'm wearing blue jeans and a black t-shirt. Same thing I wore yesterday.
You're a natural, yeah. You got it. It's your look. Yeah, so I was on there, and then I found myself on some art website with, like, I don't even know, these collectors who have these entire collections of period art from Japan. So there was a Meiji era in Japan, Meiji era. And it was like mid 1800s to early 1900s. And I can't quite remember the history, and I'm not about to like fuck it up and offend someone. So do your own research. But the art during that period was freaking phenomenal. Like the botanicals and animals and like florals, it's just so good. There's tons of bugs, so if you're into bugs, I don't know, but there's this collection of enamel vases, and that dragon and tiger were on one of the vases, and it was just like one of those, that's it, you know, like that's just it. So I went with
no
that.
Shit.
Yeah,
it came out fucking amazing. I love that. I love so like, especially with like tattoos and stuff, my two favorite styles are like traditional American, traditional Japanese. I got the fucking samurai on my, actually I can't even fucking,
oh,
I got the samurai
cool.
With the seppuku, like fucking cutting open his stomach and shit.
Nice.
But yeah, I love the paint job. I love the Japanese traditional kind of style, and that's amazing that you hand painted it. How long did it take to hand paint that design on there?
For the tank, it really only took me a few days.
Oh no shit.
Yeah, it didn't take too long at all. I think the longest part was with the enamel paint. You kind of have to wait for one layer to dry before you go in because it gets kind of tacky and weird. So there was a few days spaced out, but 3 or 4 days maybe.
No shit.
Mm-hmm.
And did you cover that with clear or is that, that's the top coat?
I did.
Okay.
Yeah, so I covered that with 2K and I covered the whole bike with 2K after I was like done painting like the pinstripe on the fender and the, you know, oil bag and stuff. I just sprayed the whole thing.
No shit. Because I've heard, I mean, everything I've read is like, you can't clear over enamel paint.
No, you can. You just got to use hardener.
I actually added in hardener to it. I'm glad you mentioned
that. The hardener, okay.
I did mix in a hardener with that before because I knew I was going to clear it. So I've fucked up enough shit to know I need to add in a hardener.
Yeah.
Doing anything because I just don't know if I'll spray it or not, so I just rather be safe.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I did not on the enamel. I did the pinstriping on that shovel or the flames with my Bobo, and I did not clear over it just because I was afraid that this is the last step, like edging the flames out, and I was like, I don't want to fuck it up at this point because I spent so much time fucking it up. I had to start from scratch because I had a weird reaction putting some clear coat on and the entire tank. So I did the base coat, I did the flames, I did the image transfer, and then I sprayed on some fucking, it's the same clear coat. I've always used the Spray Max 2K, and the whole thing just crackled. It just went, and it was Yeah, and I was just like, of course, the first person I text is Dan. And I'm like, Dan, I currently have a gun in my mouth. Can you please tell me to take, you know, talk me out of this? And the only way to do it was to fucking strip it, start over again. Can't really fix it when it's that fucked up.
Damn.
Yeah. So, yeah, definitely the paint game is fucking tough. And
it is. Yeah.
It's cool. So are you, I mean, hand painting stuff like that, I mean, you were into art prior to, like, what other kind of art forms did you do? Were you always a painter? Did you, like, paint on fucking canvas and shit, too?
Yeah, so I've been an artist my whole life, pretty much. I'm pretty, like, free-spirited. A little out there. So it just kind of comes natural. I just do a lot of different stuff, but primarily it's always been painting for me. So I really love to work with acrylics. I would love to get into oil painting, but I have so much acrylic shit, I can't like justify spending more on other things.
Yeah, oil ain't cheap either, right?
Yeah, it's so expensive. But I'm really looking to get into some more like canvas pieces, or like even on tanks or fenders or whatever, just like that, like, I don't know what the word is, like graphic art, more like things like that, I guess. So Ralphie, he has a David Mann chopper with a David Mann piece on one of his tanks, and it was airbrushed on there, but he wanted one that was hand painted. So I was like, well, I can do that, you know, send me your tank. So just things like that. I find it easier to, like, I don't know, just manipulate it and work with it.
Yeah.
And I don't want to insult anybody that's an airbrusher, but it's way cool when it's hand painted.
Yeah, I've never dabbled into airbrushing before.
Me neither, mostly because I know I won't be able to do it. But I agree, hand painting is... That's actually the zone that I'm trying to get more into now, yeah, rather than like the traditional pinstriping.
Yeah.
Like doing more of like that tattoo flash type shit. Yeah. And like rat fangs. Like that's my jam right now.
That's cool. I like that.
I know that. If you have like, you know, it's definitely an aesthetic, right, that you can only achieve by actually hand painting it. And mm-hmm. dudes will pay a lot of motherfucking money for a Survivor chop with like a wizard hand painted on it, you know, with like that fucking... Oh, yeah.
The wizards are my shit. And, like, the dragons and stuff. Yeah. Yeah, I love that stuff.
Yeah. And you can't, you know, you can't, like, a lot of painters, too, they're more technical. They're not as artistic, you know, like, to draw something on and hand paint something on, you know, like, that's a tall order. They're more, like, you know, precise with the tape and the image transfers and stuff. And you can definitely get some really intricate, cool photos, you know, like, the fantasy stuff and, like, these art pieces, if you want to go down that route with the image transfers. But there's just something to be said by, yeah, just having like a fucking weird wizard like hand painted on your tank.
I think like when you got the brush strokes in it,
yeah,
so sick.
Mm-hmm. I love that. It like just shows
so sick.
And it just has like more personality or soul in it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, my brother, he wants me to do his Dyna, and he wants like that West Coast, like, you know, Dyna club style, I think is what it's called, with the panels. But he's really into like lurking class and like sketchy tank art. So I don't know if you guys are familiar with that or not.
I was gonna say lurking class.
Yes.
What's that?
They have like badass designs. They're like all black and white pretty much, and they're pretty modern. They're kind of like doodles, but skulls and like grim reapers and stuff. Very cool. So he wants me to do something kind of like that on his dyno. But he is so fucking up his ass about if there's a brush stroke in it, and I'm like, I'm not a printer, man. Like, you know, we can wet sand it down and we can lacquer over it and stuff and it'll be smooth, but it's hand painted. The brush stroke is the coolest part.
Yeah, it's painted with a brush, there's gonna be a brush stroke.
yeah
so
I'm excited to do that, though. Yeah.
Black and white, is that kind of like McKeague art, like he does those, they're typically black and white and fucking
I don't know, I'm not familiar with them. Yeah.
Oh yeah, McKeague art. He does like stuff like skulls and he's like, yeah, Darren McKeague, he's like the shit.
He does a lot of like Sharpie art too.
It sounds like right alley.
Like graffiti style.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's cool.
Yeah.
You're he's getting like more the into dude. The graffiti, your Loctite.
I love graffiti. That's like that was my jam growing up. And then now I'm just now bringing that into like my pinstriping.
That's cool. I like that. You don't see it a lot.
You don't see it from many people at all. A lot of people. I don't know. Actually, the only one I really know that does it is Chunky Monkey.
Yeah. Oh, I was going to mention fucking your boy from the Greasy Dozen from PA with the shovel. He had a graffiti artist paint his shovel.
Yeah, that was the first time he ever used enamel paint.
That was sick, dude.
Yeah, he's never touched enamel paint in a brush ever. He's just a graffiti street artist.
That's pretty impressive, honestly.
Yeah.
That was my favorite paint job, dude. That was so sick. Cool. Yeah. Yeah, dude. I love that. I love, like, synergizing shit like that, you know, like street art, like fucking graffiti, and then, like, put it on a bike or put it on, like, it came out fucking so amazing, too, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's like, dude, you can only see so many goddamn chopper flames before you're like, okay, I get it, you know? And, like, also, like, the garage building stuff, like, I really pride myself on doing everything myself. And it's not perfect. It's not 100% perfect, but it's like, that's the spirit of what I like. I like people that work with their hands. And that's why I love the hand painting stuff, because it's like, yeah, you could definitely send it to a professional painter for $1,200 and get a sick ass fucking tank that looks like glass, but it's like, I'm not made of money, bud. You know?
Yeah.
Doing it yourself really, you know, is the way to go. And I'd like to do some more hand painting stuff too. I hand painted my helmet, my Rhino helmet, and I actually ordered a new helmet. Loctite. Oh, we were talking the other week. I think it was last week. I got myself a half helmet. I'm going back to the half helmet, but I got to paint it, and I got to put something low life on it. So I'm going to do some hand painting on that one too.
Sick.
Nice.
Yeah.
Maybe a wizard. Maybe a dragon.
I'd probably do a dragon. I'm not a huge wizard guy. When I see a cool wizard, I'm just like, that's cool. It's kitschy.
Yeah.
You know? But I don't like wizards. I'm not like a Lord of the Rings guy.
But
dragons, fuck yeah. Samurais, that shit.
Yep.
So how far is Fuel Cleveland from you?
It's only about 3 hours. Straight up, like one main road in Ohio. Ohio roads are pretty simple. You got 71, it goes up and down, and then you got 70 that goes this way, and then if you're in Columbus, we have a circle. So we just shot right up 70, all the way up. It wasn't far at all, especially since we like went in on Friday and left Sunday. It didn't feel like anything. So a lot of people came from like pretty far, like. We met some guys who had rode in from New York that day on his jockey shift, like 20 over chop. It was so cool. But oh, I was fuck. Like, damn, you must be like sore right now.
Was that fucking Maltese Machine Co?
I don't know. Maybe.
I think he went up there.
I don't remember.
He's the Lord of the Front Ends.
Oh, I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah.
It was pretty sweet. It was a pretty cool one.
Oh, dude, actually, I think Bonneville Bill said he was taking Stinky Pinky up there.
Really?
The one with the cheetah and it's pink?
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that one there. That was cool.
Yeah, yeah, that's Bonneville Bill.
I think that was in the show last year.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, he actually, that front end, he worked with Maltese Machine Co. On that front end, and we did an episode with him. He came up, he drove from New Jersey on that fucking thing. That's wild.
Very cool.
Yeah, actually, I saw shout out Shovel Sam. I saw a picture of him out there too. He made it out to Fuel Cleveland.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah. I don't know where the fuck he is now. He's in like Kentucky or some shit. It was a haul. He was texting me and he was like, yeah, I'm thinking about trying to make it up there. But yeah, dude, people came from all over the place. That's a big deal. Where do people stay at Fuel Cleveland? People just renting hotels? Because it's in an urban area, right?
It's like in the Cuyahoga National Forest area. Oh. So it's really beautiful. There's a lot of camping options, which is like, next year, I want to do that. That sounds really fun. But like, that whole event is so professional and organized. Like, Mikey sends out a list of hotels. So we just stayed at like the Hampton Inn or whatever. Everything is like 15, 20 minutes away. So it's super easy. Really nice, windy, curvy roads. But it's not like so city that it's like congested and trafficy.
Yeah.
Just like so chill. It's beautiful up there.
So how did you end up there? Because it seemed like a last minute thing. Were you invited? Like,
Yeah. I don't know how it happened. So it just like, as soon as that chop got done, so many things fell into place like that week. My head is still kind of spinning on it. So Drew from Evolution Cycles, who is like actually so fucking skilled at fabricating and building, hit me up on TikTok and was like, hey, I saw you just finished your chop. Go talk to Mikey about it for Fuel. And I was like, oh yeah, well I'm going to Fuel as well. And so I knew it was like a pretty big whoop to like get in, you know? So I just shot my shot and then Mikey's like, oh hell yeah, bring it. And I was like, cool. And then I get there and I'm like looking at knuckleheads and flatheads around me and I'm like, oh my god, wait, why me? Like, that's so crazy. So
no shit. Is that Evolution Cycle 618?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, dude, that guy's a beast, man. I love his shit. I really want to get him on the show too. I actually ran I won a set of his bars on Christmas morning that I ran on my Sporty. Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah. He's really good.
Oh my god. His pan head is like, that is like the blueprint for like the chopper that I wanted to build. And you know, for me at least, first chopper, didn't really know what I was doing. I love what I got, so that was cool.
Yeah.
But it wasn't what I envisioned, but his pan head bandit, that thing is so balanced, geometrically, like, perfectly aligned. Everything is so fucking, it's patinaed perfectly. It looks so nice. So,
yeah, I think he was one that was, he went out for People's Champ this year or this past year or something, and I was like, that dude's gonna win. Like, because I've been following him for a long time, and he's so fucking skilled. He's awesome, dude. I'd love to have him on. He seems like a really low key chill dude too.
He is so nice. He'll just talk to you like forever. Like, you can just carry on a conversation. It's so easy to talk to him.
Yeah. So how much time between when you were like, you reached out to Mikey till you were at Fuel Cleveland? Was it like 2 weeks?
I think it was like a week. Like
a week.
It was
okay.
Pretty short. Yeah.
It seems, seemed like really soon.
Yeah. Like, I was definitely taking the chop up no matter what. I just thought I'd be riding around.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah. So I just got to park in the farm. So
yeah.
Really sweet.
Yeah, Fuel Cleveland. I got to get out to that show. Maybe next year or something. Oh,
it's really fun. Yeah, especially like the night events. We went to some tiki bar the first night, and like that was fine. It was mostly fun just walking around, looking at all the bikes, and shooting the shit with people. But the next night, it was at, like, some AmVet bar. That was my shit, dude. All the chops were rolling up down the street all night. It was so cool.
Yeah, I saw that AmVet event. That looked like it was a chopper event too, right? Wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And they had kegs out, so
That's what it was. It was a keg party at an AmVet, and I was like, "That's my fucking shit. I'd fit right the fuck in, dude. I haven't been to a keg party in a long time."
It was.
I kind of forgot they even existed.
Yeah.
We got to bring back the keg party, dude. We got to bring back the keg party.
Dude, I haven't seen somebody throw a keg party in years.
I might get a keg for fucking DBR, bro.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. We're going to set it up under our tank when we do, under our tent when we're doing our live podcast. And I'll be doing keg stands.
Hell yeah.
That'll be intense.
It's been a long time since I did a keg stand.
Oh my God. I've never done a keg stand.
Never?
No. I've been to one keg party like in my entire life, and well, actually two since last week, but one before that, and I never got the opportunity.
Oh shit. Man, that's what we used to do. Like, growing up in New Hampshire, there is nothing out here. There's like no nightlife, so you grab kegs and you go out into the forest and you just get eviscerated,
hammered,
and you do keg stands, and then you just fight. Once all the girls are like, oh yeah, this fucking sucks, I don't want to stand out in the woods.
You guys are fucking losers.
Yeah, by a bonfire. Then you have a bunch of drunk, angry guys that are fucking shit-faced, and you just fight each other in the woods.
And not even because they're mad. They'd be like, you can't handle your alcohol, pussy, and then you just fight.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a lot of that. Like, you fucking lightweight, you know? Like, if you weren't, you have to do keg stands and drink fucking copious amounts of booze all goddamn night and keep your composure. So if you acted out, if you're like you're stumbling, you know, people would just swarm you like, you fucking loser.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that's why now I can drink myself into a blackout and people won't even know. I've perfected it.
Dude, some of my friends are like that, and it is eerie, cuz like I'm like, yeah, they're totally with the shit right now. They get it.
Oh, no. Yeah.
No. Clock out.
Yeah. I mean, some people like me, I typically, once I start blacking out, I find a bed and
you just like fade off into the bush like Homer Simpson.
I was going to use that same analogy, dude. I'm just like, I'm still smiling. I'm like having a good time. And then I just disappear. I'm like fucking Houdini.
You're like aware enough to remove yourself.
It's oh, yeah.
Just like that to me. Like I don't even get the chance.
Yeah. Well, I have some buddies, like actually my older brother is like this. He'll black out and he'll be up for 7 hours, just blacked out, doing God knows what, you know? Me, I find a bed and I go to bed and I wake up and I feel like shit. But yeah, my older brother, dude, he's just like, he'll be blacked out 7 hours and you'll have to fill him in the next day if you're lucky enough to be around for it. Yeah.
The worst hangover of my life. This was 2020 New Year's Eve. Me and Jacob threw really bitchin' parties. That's like our specialty. So I turned our entire house into like a speakeasy with like brick walls, all the shit, whatever.
Damn.
I was so excited for this fucking party, getting ready all day, jello shots, whatever. I didn't eat. And then at like 8 o'clock, people start showing up. And one of my friends brought Bacardi 151. And they were like, God. Do you want a shot? And I'm like, sure, I've never had that. It's a holiday. Let's have a shot. I took one shot and then I had one beer, blacked out. I was blacked out from 9 p.m. until 5:30 a.m.
Oh,
awake
Jesus.
And walking around. I have no recollection. There are Listen. Pictures of me. I'm doing fire shots. More 151. Why'd they do that to me? I don't know.
Fun story. The first time I ever got drunk, I was camping with my family and met these older kids. I was probably 14. And they're like, dude, drink with us. Oh so God. I was like, went into this sketchy meth trailer in the middle of the woods and drank an entire bottle of 151 with them. And I guess my dad found me. I was like walking in front of our campsite and was like moping. And I was like, I'll never find my way home. And then, so he like grabbed me, was like, you fucking idiot, you obviously want to kill me.
Oh
He's like,
God.
Get in your tent, we'll talk about this in the morning. So I walked over to the tree and I was like trying to unzip the pine tree because I thought that was my tent. Yeah, I was fucked.
Dude.
And fuck those kids, like, obvious, like, you're an older dude, you're going to let me get blackout drunk and wander off in the woods?
That was your first time getting drunk?
First time ever, like,
how old were you?
Fucking, like, 14.
Jesus Christ, dude.
That's rough. You
well, actually, no, I must have been younger than that because I got suspended from school in the 8th grade for having a 6-pack and a bowl. So I must have been younger than that. I was probably like 7th grade. However old you are then.
What is that, like 12?
Something like that.
Oh
I
my
think.
God.
Jesus Christ, bud. Yeah, that 151 is fucking
worse now
dangerous.
That shit should be outlawed.
Dude, moonshine? Yeah.
It, didn't that?
Dude.
Like, I'm all for having a good time, but that should be fucking outlawed.
Did you guys ever have the Four Locos before they got, like, revamped?
I never did.
I never did.
You didn't. I'm so surprised you didn't, actually. I did in high school. Yeah. I was, like, a goody two-shoes, but I had a Four Loco in high school, and I smoked a cigarette. So, that was my crazy wild high school time.
Yeah, dude, we didn't. I missed the Four Loco train for whatever reason. I've always been a beer guy.
When I was younger, I was never a beer guy when I was younger. Because it was just cheaper to buy a bottle and then, like, split it with everybody.
Yeah.
So, like, all, like, through 7th, 8th, and then all the way through high school, we were either drinking Hennessy, E&J, or Goldschlager. And we would just crush a handle, like, every Friday night, me and two of my buddies. We're getting after it.
Yeah, Goldschlager was the shit. I remember that was, like, the shit. But, yeah, dude, drinking young. Like, I'm going to tell my kids, smoke some weed, baby. You know, just, like, smoke as much. Get high as a motherfucker.
Just
and watch some,
it.
Like,
yeah.
fucking, you know, anime or something in the basement. Do not go out and get drunk, because you are going to get in a lot of trouble. And you're going to come very close to death.
Weed's a safer option. Definitely.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. And nowadays, it's like, well, everything has fentanyl in it, so just stay away from...
Including beer.
Yeah. Dude, I wouldn't be surprised you buy some moonshine off some hillbilly and there's fucking fentanyl in it.
He's like, Jesus. I got the best shine in the county.
Yeah, just sprinkle a little fentanyl. Whoop.
Oh,
just a little
God.
Pinch. Oh, dude, they're just salting the rim in fucking fentanyl. Like a margarita. Jesus Christ. Yeah, dude. I really want to get out to Fuel Cleveland. What is it, like 12 hours out to Ohio, out that way? Something like that?
Yeah, it's somewhere. Yeah, I think it took me 14 hours on a bike.
Like half a day, yeah.
Now, do you go highways or do you like back road it?
The time I went on the bike, we went highway the entire time. Did about probably 85, 90 the whole way.
Yeah. It's tough getting out of New England. I feel like every
it's
time
the
I'm
worst. That's the
it's
worst
like
part.
Escape from New York type shit, you know, like Snake Plissken. You got to get out in New England and then it's cruising, it's, dude.
Once you get on the other side of Hartford, Connecticut, then you're in the clear.
Yeah. Yeah. It's tough. It's like very dense up here and lots of traffic, really shitty traffic.
Yeah. I'm not too good with geography, but every time I look at a map, I'm like kind of shocked at how compressed everything is in that corner. You know,
oh, yeah, it's tiny.
Crazy.
Cramped.
Yeah. Yeah. New Hampshire's tiny. All the New England states are really tiny.
You can hit four states in one day. Easy.
That's crazy. Now, easy. Are all states like...
I can hit four states from where I live in 4 hours.
Damn. So do all the states have kind of like similar laws like about helmets and shit like that?
Not Massachusetts.
So Massachusetts, you have to wear a helmet.
It's like California.
But New Hampshire, Vermont, and Maine, there's no helmet law.
Yeah.
But I'm here to say, if you don't wear a helmet, you're a dummy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you should definitely wear a helmet.
Too many friends die.
Yeah. You only get one of these.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wear a helmet. I mean, basically, a lot of, like, so Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, very similar law-wise with helmets, guns, and seatbelts and shit. And then Massachusetts is like California.
Yeah, times 10.
Yeah.
They just have to be different.
They have to be a pain in the fucking ass.
Commonwealth state.
Yeah. But, once you get out of there, I mean, you have to drive. Like, if I go down to, I'm driving down to Connecticut, I'm going to go through four states, you know, to get there. And then you're almost out of New England after
That's
4 hours.
Crazy.
Yeah.
It takes me like 2 hours in any direction to get to a different state where I'm at.
That's crazy.
Yeah, and Ohio's big. You can fit like 14 New Hampshires in there.
Oh my God. Wait, that's
But New Hampshire's long, though. Like, New Hampshire and Vermont are like very long states.
Yeah.
Same with Maine, actually. Any like New England state that goes to Canada is long as fuck.
Yeah.
Because like, you can go from...
You can drive through from north to southern Mass in an hour. Yeah.
Yeah, you can go from Mass, New Hampshire, Maine in 20 minutes.
Yeah.
It's fucking weird. But if you're going towards Canada, it's 4+ hours.
Oh, yeah. It's if you're going to, like, strange. Montreal, it's, like, 6 hours from southern New Hampshire, you know? But if you drive across the state, no problem. It's thin. It's kind of like my penis. Long and thin.
Jesus Christ.
No, but Mass is the same way. It's just turned sideways. Like, western Mass to eastern Mass is... That's a long haul, but you can drive right through Mass in an hour.
Yeah.
Like from border to border.
Yeah.
That's so crazy to me.
I mean, unless you're going like north to south, because then like you got the Cape and all that shit, which is pretty far.
Oh, yeah. And it's not that, it doesn't take that long. I mean, if you're in Massachusetts too, if you're taking 93 through Boston, you're going to get fucked with traffic.
Yeah.
Dude, I've been in traffic in Boston. Like when I lived down there, I lived down in the South End. And, bro, I'd be in traffic for 4 hours on a Friday night. 4 hours sitting in your car.
Yeah, the That's easiest, cool. like, when I went to Ohio, we don't go through Mass because it just takes way too long.
Yeah.
So we go through Vermont, up into New York, and then drop down into Ohio. That's the fastest way to go.
Yeah, and that's the way we're going to Deadbeat, too. We're going up, through Vermont and then dropping down, because you can go down and across, but you're all in Mass, and Mass just fucked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I went to Akron, Ohio.
Oh, yeah, I think that's, we were pretty close to Akron, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm not too familiar with Northern Ohio, so that could be completely inaccurate, but I'm pretty sure, because I think LeBron's from Akron.
I think you're right.
And I know that, so, yeah.
Yeah, oh, I hate that. I hate that city now.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't went, like
Northern. I didn't spend a lot of time in Ohio. I've been there, like, briefly. I spent a night in Youngstown.
Hmm.
That place is a shithole.
Yep. Not familiar with that. Southern Ohio is the shit, though.
What is?
We got the most beautiful, like, hills, like, Hocking Hills, so pretty. Pike County.
Oh, where you are, okay.
Freaking great, yeah.
Yeah.
Southern Ohio is where it's at, yeah.
Yeah, is Ohio part of the Midwest?
Yes.
It is part of the Midwest, but you are in Eastern time.
Yeah. Yeah, go figure. I don't...
Okay.
Man, I don't know. It's just like a strange thing. I've always wondered that too. Like, it doesn't
Mid-East,
seem...
Right?
Midwest. Yeah, it seems Mid-East to me, honestly.
We should do something about that. We should write our fucking local senator or some shit. Because you guys should be... There should be a Mid-East in a Midwest. Because Midwest, you have to be West. You have to be in a different time zone.
At all. We're like east of the Mississippi.
You're like so, Western New England.
Fine. Yeah. I don't know, man. Whoever decided that, clearly.
Yeah, but Ohio gets tornadoes and shit, so they can't really have, they can't be part of New England.
Oh, that's true. We get a lot of tornadoes, actually.
You guys get a fuck ton lately.
It's horrifying where I live. We have this...
I know, you look like you live in, like, Iowa, by the way.
Yeah.
Every time I see you post a picture, I'm like, where the hell is she?
We live on the edge of the Appalachian Plateaus, so it's, like, really flat where I am, but I can see all the Appalachian Mountains if I look south. Like, it's really... It's so pretty where I'm at, and then you'll just be driving on flat land, and all of a sudden, it's, like, a huge valley in front of you, but that's a plateau, actually. It's very cool. Yeah, we get a lot of flat stuff. It's a lot of corn, a lot of beans where I'm at. I live on a farm.
Yeah, that's what I always see in your pictures. I was like, she has to live on a farm. I always see corn in your pictures.
Yeah.
I'm like, I think she lives in Iowa.
A family farm. No. Yeah, so Chicken has a family farm, and then he blessed us with this old dilapidated farmhouse. He's like, you guys can have it if you want to redo it. And I don't think he was serious, and we were like, we'll redo it. And we've spent the past 3 years renovating a fucking house, and it's just tough, man.
So you have animals out there? Do you have chickens and shit?
No.
Not yet?
Just choppers. That's it. That's enough.
Choppers and corn.
Yeah.
Choppers and corn, yeah.
Choppers and corn. That's about it. Yeah, we rent the land out, so we have, like, farmers who come and...
Oh, nice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
How much... you have some acreage out there, then?
Yeah, I don't know how much it is, honestly. I don't pay attention, because one day I'm going to have to, like, take over, you know, and, like, manage. But right now I'm just kind of like, I don't know.
Yeah. Good job, farmer guy.
Yeah, I'm like, farmer, just let me ride in your tractor with you. They're always out there. The other week he was spraying the beans, and that's when I did that photo shoot where I'm on my Sportster, like, laying across it, and he honked at me in his sprayer, and I was like, okay.
Oh, so that's cool. So you kind of co-opt that out to farmers, and they can plant their crops on your land. Do they like kick back some money or anything?
Yeah, I think they pay to rent the land.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah.
I didn't know people did that. That's pretty cool.
I got a buddy that does that. Dude, he makes like 10 grand a crop season.
Dang.
Oh, fuck.
I was like, god damn, son.
Pretty good. Pretty good for own land.
No shit. What kind of beans? Do they give you some crops too?
Yeah.
Oh, soy. Beans.
Yeah.
Oh man, you must have deer all over the place out there.
We do. We actually sit out with our guns sometimes and look through the scopes at all the deer in the back forest. We're like, we could just pop them right now, but we don't, because it's like illegal. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, we keep watch out. We have a forest behind our house, and there's some pretty nice ones back there right now.
Oh no shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, that's, I would love to have like some serious acreage, you know, like 100+ acres.
Oh, that'd be cool.
I'd love to be one of those farmer dudes that someone comes out like trying to collect like fucking taxes and I'm like, get off my property. Yeah. Blast a fucking shotgun and shot into the air, you know.
We have to do that like once a week, so you can just come hang with us sometime and we'll show you how to do it.
Yeah, maybe next year when we come through for Fuel Cleveland, I'm going to convince Loctite to go with me.
Let me host you guys. Come to the Southern Ohio.
So down for Fuel Cleveland.
Yeah, you guys should.
Yeah, we'll go out into the bean farm and fucking lasso a few deer, run them, ride them around.
Yeah, I'll take you to Smitty's. We'll have a bike night. Yeah. It'll be great.
Yeah, so Smitty's, you mentioned that earlier. That's like your local like bike spot.
Yeah, it's like our community center. Like some people have a church. We have Smitty's. So it's like all the old farts in town just go congregate every Friday night. Joe and Sabrina own it. Shout out Joe and Sabrina. They do so much for the community. Like they donate to the charities in town and they set up like a little box for people to like put food in or like books or whatever.
Oh, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah, they're so cool. And that's just like where all my friends are. Like all my friends are 70-year-old men and women, and we just like to talk and talk shit and drink beer together. So
that's old like people are cool as fuck, that's dude. I like it. I love hanging out with old dudes and old chicks. You know, they're just like more in line with like they're just easier to talk to.
Compass.
I don't have any friends under the age of fucking like 30. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just can't relate to that demographic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, aside from my brother, he's 25. He's like the only youngin'.
There's a few diamonds in the rough. Like some of I talk about our listenership, and I got hit up by a bunch of young 20-year-old dudes. And you guys are diamonds in the rough. You guys are unique. You are beautiful, because that sentiment, like the values and the things that you know, like people think are cool. Mm-hmm. I'm more in line with a 70-year-old man with like a bunch of health problems than I am with like a fucking 30-year-old, you know?
Yeah. They're so cool because they're just so authentically themselves. Like they just truly don't give a flying shit about what anyone thinks. Yeah. And I think that's the coolest thing that anyone can do, you know?
That's honestly like the time that I'm on right now.
Mm-hmm.
I just like, me and Rhino were just talking about that before we started the show today.
Yeah.
And that's just like where I'm at in life right now. Is like I don't give a motherfuck.
Yeah.
Who likes me or what I'm doing.
Yeah.
If we get along, we get along. If we don't, fuck it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't gotta pretend anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Back to the pinstriping thing. So where did the name Angel Claw come from? What is that?
I'm so glad you asked. It's
I'm a
very
great interviewer.
Story.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Okay. So as I mentioned, I'm kind of a dumbass. And so one time we were in Florida, Chicken's a snowbird. Side note, Chicken is my dad. He's a 70, 80-year-old biker dude. He's actually like 79. So anyway, we're down in Florida and we were heading out for a ride one morning and he was talking to Jacob. I was getting on the back of the bike and he was saying, don't ride faster than your guardian angel can fly. And so I never fucking heard that in my life. And so I thought he was calling me Angel for some godforsaken reason. And I was so excited because all I've ever wanted is for him to give me a nickname, because like he has Chicken, his friend is Taco. Like they all have their fucking names. So I'm like, oh my God, he called me Angel. That's my name. That's it. And so I was too elated. Like he couldn't tell me no. So that was just it for a minute. And then later that summer was actually when White Claws came out. So like 2018 or something, I don't know. Smitty's. I was like, oh, you guys have to get White Claws. I love them. Please get them for me. And so Sabrina ordered them. And I drank all their fucking White Claws, like all of them in one bike night. And so that's where the claw came from. So.
I knew it had something to do with White Claws.
Yeah, that's a good one. Is how I got my name.
I love that. That's a good one. Yeah, I love it. You know, you can't necessarily pick your own nickname. You know what I mean? And it's funny how it comes around. You know,
yeah.
It's kind of a convoluted story too, because you're given your nickname from people that know you and have experienced things. So
yeah,
yeah. I was wondering, yeah. Angel Claw. I was like, what is that about? So yeah, White Claws and yeah. Angel. Now you say you said your dad is 79.
He's yeah. He was born in 1946.
Holy shit! How many siblings do you have?
I just have one sibling.
Just you and your brother?
Just me and Zach.
Well, and he's younger too. He's younger than you. You said he's in his 20s.
Yeah. So Chicken is actually my stepdad. Okay. And I love my biological dad. So my mom and my dad had me and my brother Zach, and then they split when I was like 13, and then my mom and Chicken got together when I was 16, and so.
That's kind of okay.
That. Yeah, my mom is like 16 years younger than Chicken. He's just like a major stud muffin, and
she actually fucking picked awesome.
Him up at the bar. Yeah, like she went up and bought him a beer, and my mom's really fucking cool, so she pulled it off and married him. So he's
fuck yeah, dude.
He's been like the coolest guy.
Dude, way to go, Chicken.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, I was like, dude, he's fucking almost 80, and you're pretty young, and your brother's definitely young. So yeah. I was like, holy shit. How did do you know how he got his nickname?
Honestly,
do you want to know?
Every time he tells me this, I'm really fucked up and I don't remember. And so maybe you guys can invite him on the podcast. I'm sure he'd love to tell you.
I would love to get Chicken on the podcast. Yes. Yeah.
Has stories.
Please make that happen for us.
Yeah. Plug in your phone because you'll be on here for like 4 hours. Like he just fucking talks.
Fuck please make that happen.
I will. Well,
I actually have an uncle that his name is Rooster.
Really?
Yeah. Very and cool. Because he raises Rooster. Because back in the day, like cockfighting used to be like a very big thing. Mm-hmm. My uncle's older. And so that's why he got the name nickname Rooster. Because he always had the most badass rooster.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
That's wild.
Yeah. Yeah. So Chicken's who got me into choppers and everything. I was... Like I said, I was like a major goody two shoes growing up. I was like really afraid to break rules and I was like a major people pleaser. And then Chicken walked in and was like, you know, whatever. He just is who he is. And that's what I love about it. And so I was like, damn, I want to be like that when I get older. And
that's
so
awesome.
I did.
Yeah. It's like, hey, you know, you can do whatever you want whenever you want.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
There's no laws against that.
Nope.
That's awesome.
Yeah, Chicken sounds like my spirit animal at this point.
Yes. He is so funny. Every day it's something new with him, I swear to God. He just talks. And
does he still ride?
Yeah. Yeah.
Fuck yeah.
He has an 86 Heritage Softail that he bought brand new. It's actually one of two. He's only bought two brand new bikes in his life. And he has like 10 or 12. I don't know. But he still has a Softail, and he named it Red, and he still rides it. And that's why Evos are my favorite, because that is the best sounding bike I've ever heard in my fucking life.
That
sounds like a horse trotting, or like a heartbeat. It's so, so nice. So, yeah, he still rides. We go to bike nights, and we can go again.
That's so fun.
I want to get him on the podcast so bad now.
I'll make it happen. He would be very flattered.
No shit. Yeah, we definitely. I think that's like originally when we had talked about getting you on, you were like, you got to get him on too. And but does he winters over, doesn't he? Doesn't he go down south or something?
Yeah, so he goes to Florida usually in like October or so.
Yeah.
And then he comes back in May.
Okay.
He doesn't tolerate the cold and he doesn't tolerate the heat. So like he just kind of bounces wherever the weather is.
We'll try to coordinate that before he snowbirds down south.
Okay. That'd be great.
That would be awesome.
I'll show him your TikTok. He loves TikTok. Right now he's on that. Yeah, he loves it. Yeah. He watches Cactus Panhead. Do you guys follow Cactus?
I think so, yeah.
I don't know.
He's really cool. I love Cactus. He's an old guy like Chicken. He just rides. He's from Canada. He like rode through the blizzard last year and stuff. So Chicken gets on there every morning and like holds the phone this close and he like watches his little friend online. It's so cute.
That's so cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
No shit, dude. Yeah, old dudes are cool as fuck. Especially if they're still like keeping it real. At fucking 80, dude, I pray I can still ride a bike. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I ain't headed for you know, that like, you know, being a centennial or being 100 years old, you know. But he must be is he a skinny dude?
Yeah, he's like,
yeah. Skinny dudes can outlast. Yeah.
He's like over 6'2", and he has like the biggest fucking hands and feet you've ever seen in your life. He looks like Sasquatch or something. I don't even know. He got like the genetic lottery, but he just doesn't let the old man in. Like, he That's just awesome. Refuses to believe that he's old.
That's what you gotta do. Just keep on acting young.
Yeah.
Trick father time.
Oh my God, the funniest fucking story. Let me tell you guys about this. About 3 weeks ago, we went over to the Eagles or something. I don't know. Chicken's a member of the Eagles. We're walking in. This sweet old lady, okay, she looks like SpongeBob's grandma. So sweet looking. Comes out and she's like, and this happens everywhere we go. She's like, are you the chicken man? And he's like, yeah, I'm chicken. And she's like, you gave me a ride in your 19 whatever Cougar in 1969. And he was like, oh, I did? And she's like, yeah, and I threw up all over you.
Jesus.
In 1969.
Yeah. And he's like, oh, I remember that. And she's like, yeah, she called it a wacky, a joint. She's like, you were smoking a wacky. And it didn't sit well with me. Or like, she tried to smoke it or something and she threw up all over it.
Oh my God.
But like, everywhere we go. And then immediately after the Eagles, we went to Smitty's. Some lady came up and she's like, Chicken, I found this picture of you from my house party in like 75. And she just hands him this Polaroid. And there he is. You know, whatever. He's fucking just like chicken. Famous everywhere we go. Yeah.
That's fucking amazing.
Ladies, man.
Yeah. That's so cool. That's what I look forward to about becoming old and being like, being able to remember the year I threw up on someone. You know, you meet them in a fucking bingo hall and be like, hey, remember when I fucking threw up on you 40 years ago?
Oh my God. Yeah. Me and my mom were like pissing ourselves. It was so funny. She was just the sweetest looking, like most unassuming old lady ever.
Oh yeah. That's fucking awesome.
So what do you do for work?
So I work, for a company, and we do like independent contracting for government buildings.
Oh, cool.
So right now, I run a contract for a Navy base right now.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Cause you've talked about it and I'm like, man, I don't even know. Like you describe it, but I didn't know what it was.
Yeah. It's very hard to describe because it's like I'm not the one actually doing the work. I like oversee the work.
Okay.
It's very weird.
Yeah.
I'm a contractor who gets other contractors. It's fucking strange.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of it at all.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's nice that it's easy work. I've done construction my whole life, so doing this now is like,
yeah,
cool. But at the same time, I'm not an office guy, so.
Yeah, I feel that. I just kind of do my job because it pays the bills. And like, as soon as I start get anything, I'm like out of there.
Yeah.
Well, you get to work remote. You said 100%. That's fucking huge.
Well, like 90% of the time. Yeah. Sometimes I have to go into the office, but it's not that bad.
How long have you been doing that gig for?
I have worked there since 2016.
Oh, wow. Okay. So,
yeah. I was such a baby when I started there, and I'm like so embarrassed about the past, like the first couple of years I worked there. I'm like, Jesus Christ, oh my God.
Yeah.
The things I did and said, I'm like, duh.
Yeah.
It's enough to make me want to quit.
Yeah.
It's hard to beat working from home. You know, I mean, it's so easy. It's like cheating.
Cutting out the commute time. Yeah. It's so nice.
Yeah, you don't
have to
shower.
That's the part I hate the most.
Yeah. The commute?
Yeah, I commute 40 minutes each way.
Yeah, it's a grind. You have to get up at a certain time.
It's pretty much like it's an extra 2 hours that I just like give up for free.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It sucks. Mm-hmm. And like right now, I actually just got on a fire department close to me. So I'm doing that. But before I can go full-time doing that, I have to finish the fire academy and my EMT training.
Dang, that's cool.
But the thing that sucks is, like, I'm working my job. I coach football. I play youth softball. I mean, not youth softball. I do not play youth softball. I play co-ed softball.
Yeah.
And I work my regular job. And then now on top of that, I have to go to school 2 nights a week.
Damn.
So it's like, I am just...
You're busy.
We do the fucking podcast.
Yeah.
There was not one night a week that I'm just like hanging out.
Man.
Yeah. But it'll be worth it. Because once I get all that schooling done, then I can just go hang out at the fire station. And once you get there, you work 2 24-hour shifts a week. And you have the rest of the week off.
That's kind of nice. So
two days a week, really nice. And you're good to go.
That's really cool, yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
So that's the goal. Hopefully within the next year and a half, I'll be doing that.
Yeah, but this podcast blowing the fuck up, we're going to be doing this full time. We're going to tell our bosses to take this job and shove it up their ass.
There you go.
No, I've been interviewing extensively. The last 2 weeks, dude, I've had an interview every day. I had 3 today.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's like so mentally taxing. Holy shit.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm expecting like by the end of this week to have 2 or 3 offers. And by early next week, like 4.
How are you doing this? Like Zoom?
Yeah, they just do something? Like remote. They typically do like a phone screen to make sure that you're not fucking retarded. And then they pass you off to the, like the HR department does that. And they're just like, oh yeah, he's not retarded. He doesn't have Down syndrome. And then they pass you off to the hiring manager.
It's so funny, like knowing this guy for as long as I've known him and doing the show with him. And then we were going to a buddy's funeral and he was still working, by the way. Mm-hmm. So he's in the back seat of his car. I'm driving and he's like taking meetings in the back seat. And the way he switches up his vocabulary and like his accent and everything, this motherfucker should be an actor. It is insane. His business voice is the most impressive thing I've ever heard in my life.
I was drinking tall boys too.
Oh, you were pounding tall boys.
On the company meetings. Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny.
That is funny. Yeah.
I've been doing it for a long time. So, all right, guys, I want to do something a little bit new here.
Uh-oh.
I got a new segment that I want to...
A recurring segment?
What's that?
A recurring segment?
Maybe. We're going to just try things out. What we're going to do now, since we're brand new, this is the Low Life Podcast. We talked about it last week. We're going to throw spaghetti against the wall. We're going to see if it sticks. We want your feedback. We want your engagement. We want to know what you guys want to hear. And one of the things we talked about that was very popular was the kicks and the dicks. Everybody loved the kicks and the dicks.
I hate them.
But we're not going to do that. But it's in the same vein. All right? So we want a platform for you guys to be able to air out your grievances. And me and Loctite... We're little balls of stress. Every once in a while, it's cathartic to just fucking unload on some bullshit that's been fucking with you. And it doesn't have to be something that happened to you like, oh, this guy cut me off in traffic. It could just be like just generally what's pissing you off, right? Like why the fuck is this the way that it has to be? We want to hear from you guys. So I'm going to premiere, and Loctite has no idea that I did this. And there is media that goes along with this. So this is a segment I like to call, you know what really steams my beans?
You know what really steams my beans?
What the fuck?
So honored.
Who was that human?
You never seen Even Stevens?
I don't remember that person.
That's Beans.
Beans from
Even
Man,
Stevens.
Deep in my subconscious.
That's a deep cut.
Oh my god.
Oh holy shit.
So guys, you know what? I want to. This just happened to me. All right, recently, and this is something I want to get off my chest. And we're trying to keep it positive here, but again. this is kind of like a therapy session for lowlifes too, right? You don't want to go to a therapist that just sits there and takes notes and doesn't tell you what they're writing down about. Like, what are you writing down about me right now? We're not going to give you any medication. This is just a therapy session. Get shit off your chest.
Hold on. So is this like what we talked about? Like, people can just email all this stuff in and we'll just pull one every week?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I just don't want to get into the same thing as Kicks in the Dick.
No.
Where it takes us 4.5 hours to just do that segment.
We're just going
to
do one topic.
Yeah, perfect.
One topic. Feel free to write in something that's been pissing you off, and we'll pick the one maybe once a week, maybe every three weeks. Who knows?
Just at random.
Yeah, just at random. What's really steams your beans? And if you guys have a better segment name, I'm all ears. Because this one, I got to say, doesn't exactly rustle my jimmies, but it was funny. So
I love it.
You love it. If you guys love it, maybe that'll be the poll this week. If you guys love it, it steams my beans. I'm going to play it one more time.
You know what really steams my beans?
Nah, listen. That's not beans, dude.
That's beans. He's growing up.
What, when he's 60?
Yeah, he's growing up.
Look at that little creep with the weird fucking mustache.
He has a goatee.
I want beans from the show. All right,
maybe I'll change the graphics. Because, dude, you remember beans, though, right?
Yeah, now that you said it, 100% I remember.
Yeah, he had a little bit of a lift.
Even Stevens was one of my favorite shows.
Yeah,
he's
like, my name is Beans.
Right next to Boy Meets World and Fresh Prince.
Yeah.
I think Loctite's beans are steamed right now.
Oh, I'm steamed over that picture.
That's what steaming your beans? We'll change it.
Inaccurate photos.
But you know what? You know what's really been, you know, stuck in my craw? You know what's really been steaming my beans?
Let's hear it.
Yeah, I want to hear it.
Traffic lights. It's 2024. All right, I live in a small town. There's a couple of traffic lights. It's not that much of an inconvenience to wait. But the thing I can't fucking stand about traffic lights, there's two things. Number one, we have the technology and it's cheap. I mean, everything has a fucking camera in it. Everything. I mean, we have cars that drive themselves. You can't make a traffic light that just, oh, there's a car coming. You go. You know, like, to just, why do we have to impede traffic? Like, on a timer. Like, someone pulls up and then you're waiting. You wait for this guy to go and this guy goes right and then all that shit. But the thing that really steams my beans is the walk signal when there's a pedestrian. The only thing I hate more than fucking bicyclists are pedestrians. They push the fucking button and you're sitting there and you're like, dude, they put a timer up. It's like 40 fucking seconds. And then this one person like walks across the street. It's like, this isn't New York City, bro. You could have just went. You didn't need to push the button. There's not a cop posted up there. They're not going to catch you for jaywalking. Why do we have walk signals? Just go when there's not a car.
Yeah.
You don't know what pisses me off about traffic lights? Is when it doesn't pick up my fucking motorcycle.
That's exact. You have
the one
to break
at my
the
house,
law.
The one at my house.
Never does.
Literally doesn't pick up motorcycles. Every day on my way home, I have to run a red light at a four-way intersection where the speed limit is 55 miles an hour.
And what is the technology? Like, is it a pressure plate? Like, what the fuck is going on? They don't have, like, a little camera?
It's a magnet.
What is it?
It's a magnet. So sometimes the motorcycles aren't big enough to, like, trip the magnet underneath. There's a plate underneath the asphalt.
That's fucking stupid. Yeah. I've been bouncing. I thought it was a pressure plate, so I'm sitting there going like this.
People are like, what is this guy doing? And here's the other thing that pisses me off. I know bikers are scary, but if I'm at a light and it's gone through 18 rotations and I'm waving you up next to me because you're in a car behind me, pull up!
Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to tell you the light's not changing because my bike ain't fucking reading it.
Yeah. Because you can see sometimes, like, they'll have the metal outline, like, sticking out of the asphalt. And you scoot way up, and you're like, come on, get your car on here.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're just like, don't hurt me.
I thought you had to like weigh enough.
I thought it was weight.
And I'm like, maybe my chopper doesn't fucking weigh enough. I have no idea. So I'll pull up past the white line and like try to wave the car up and then just sit there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I'm like, do you enjoy sitting here for the past 15 minutes?
Yeah,
it's stupid that at this day and age that, like, how much does it cost to put in a more sophisticated traffic symbol, like, system where you can have a camera? Dude, like, you can, how cheap is it to buy a camera for your home, you know, that, like, picks up movement, you know? Like, if there's a car there, like, you can tell, right?
Like, or how about we just not have traffic lights at all?
Roundabouts.
What about the four-way intersections that don't have traffic lights now? How do people not die? Because you just fucking wait your turn.
Yeah.
Yeah, but people don't know how to drive. So, like, sometimes I do go to, like, a four-way stop, and I'm waiting. And everybody's also way over polite, and they're like, you go. And it's like,
yeah,
just take your turn.
Yeah, I'm like, no, bitch, you got here before me. You have to go.
You go now.
My means is those people. Yeah. Like, just fucking go, man.
I hate it because, like, you'll be like, go. And they're like, no, you go. And then you'll try to go and they'll try to run you over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, and the other thing is, they're waving you through. They're like, you go. Dude, I can't even see what you're doing. The sun's out. There's glare. I can't fucking see your hands. You know, so I'm sitting there. I'm like, what the fuck is this guy doing? That really sets me off. You know, that, like, the thing is, like, the thing I hate most is the walk signal because it's so long. You know, like, again, you can't have, like, a fucking motion sensor. Like, not everybody crossing the street is in a wheelchair or an old lady. You don't need 50 seconds to get across a fucking street, two lanes of traffic.
Yeah. It also always catches me off guard when there's a pedestrian sometimes. Like, there's just not that many people where I'm from. Like, it's pretty rural, you know? So on the off chance there is someone crossing the street, it's always like,
yeah, who the fuck are you?
Make yourself known.
Yeah, like those motherfuckers, like, crosswalks, you know? Like, sometimes you're going through, like, an area and people stop in the road because there's someone at a crosswalk. And you look behind you, there's no cars. You know? Yeah. It's like, just cross when I go by. Why do we have to pause?
I won't lie. I do that. I got to get in any good karma I can.
You stop for him in the crosswalk?
I mean, usually not people. Fuck pedestrians. But, like, if somebody's trying to pull out, I don't care if there's nobody behind me for 6 miles. I'm going to slow down so you can pull out because I want the good karma. I'm selfish.
Wait, you're stopping in the middle of the road?
I mean, I'm not stopping. I'm yielding. And then I'm violently flailing my arms, calling you a piece of shit if you don't pull out fast enough.
All right, so you're on the main thoroughfare and someone's pulling out of a parking lot.
I don't even know what you just said.
Like, you're on the main strip. Like, let's say, like, 128.
Can we use American language, please? Enough of your Canadian bullshit.
Is he Canadian?
What the fuck you just said.
Are you Canadian?
He's like, in the province of...
I'm French Canadian.
No fucking way.
I think I am. I don't really know. My grandparents are from Montreal area, like rural.
I'm French Canadian.
Yeah.
Nice.
Well, I'm part French Canadian, part I don't know. I'm like disco, right? I don't know what I am. I haven't taken a DNA test. I probably got a bit of Rottweiler in me too. But
anyways, yes, if somebody's trying to pull out, I'll yield for them back. Hey, come on, bud. Cuz I know. I've been there. When I'm trying to get out of my parking lot of work, it takes me 25 minutes because every piece of shit that's in traffic in the main road is in a hurry to sit in traffic and won't let me out.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, yeah, go ahead, bud. You can go.
That is how you hack the karma system, I think. That's a pretty good system.
If you do that 2 or 3 times a week,
you're good.
You're fucking bone.
Yeah, you're good.
Nah. Fuck those guys.
And, like, anybody on a motorcycle, I'll block the road for you to get out.
Yeah, motorcycle dudes, sideways. I'll definitely, like,
always.
I'm overly courteous to them. Like,
and like,
give them a wide berth, don't tailgate them, you know, all that shit.
My wife sent me this meme. It's called Adopting a Biker. And this is, like, when you're on the road and you're in a car, you just stay behind that guy to make sure nobody's going to hit him at lights.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know, like,
And I never even knew that's what it was called, but like, I'm that guy. Like, if I see a dude on a bike, I'm going to stay behind and make sure you're not going to get fucked up.
That's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. I like that. Yeah. Adopt a biker.
Very cool.
Yeah, dude, because motherfuckers are getting drilled, dude, from behind, you know?
Dude, it's crazy.
Yeah.
The amount of people, especially on like where I live, like I said, it's a 55-mile-per-hour road. And then it just comes into the fucking town. Mm-hmm. Which is 35. So people are doing 55 and there's a traffic light and just smoking motherfuckers at the traffic light nonstop.
Yep.
It sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know two people that have gotten hit in the last year just because of that. Like people not fucking slowing down in time.
Yeah.
It's rough.
Yeah, dude. That fucking shit really sets me off. Like, yeah. don't hit a motorcycle. Go ahead and like wreck a car. You know what I mean? But like when I see motorcycles and shit, I'm like, all right, it's game time. Let's pay attention. Don't be fucking with your phone and shit.
But I will say this too, though, because this would have been, if I was picking this week's fucking topic, my topic would have been the bikers that ride like shit. Because here's the thing that pisses me off is I'm a very defensive driver. But I know when to turn on, like, to ride like an asshole. You know what I mean? Yep. But when I see these guys that I know 100%, they ride probably 5-6 times a year. And they get out on that brand new Street Glide, got no helmet on, and they're doing 85 miles an hour down the fucking road, swerving in and out of traffic. I'm like, you are the reason so many people are dying on motorcycles. Because you suck at riding. I can tell because you almost fell over at the last stoplight. And you're doing 80 miles an hour trying to split lanes. You're a fucking retard.
Crazy.
That shit is, that's what pisses me off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I get really nervous when people ride like that. I hate that.
I only ride, and this sounds so fucking stupid. I only ride like that in the city. Like in backcountry, like farmland, mm-hmm. I'm just cruising 35 miles an hour. I don't take any highways. When I get out of the city, I'm lane split and I'm doing fucking 60 miles an hour through downtown because that's how I like to ride. But mm-hmm. guys, that you can tell when somebody doesn't know how to, and it pisses me the fuck off.
Yeah.
Like, just know your limit.
Is lane splitting common over where you guys are?
It's not legal.
Not legal.
People get really pissed about
be.
It.
I think it should. Yeah. It should be, honestly, because that's why people are getting fucking smoked stoplights.
In Massachusetts, you can ride in the breakdown lane at certain times, which is wicked sketch. Because there's all sorts of debris, dude.
So much. Yeah.
And you're cutting across fucking exits. Yeah, it's fucking nuts, dude. When you see
a whole tire in the breakdown lane.
Dude, motherfuckers that go in that breakdown lane, they're doing 100 plus.
Yeah.
Dude, if you're in the breakdown lane, you don't give a fuck about your life or your well-being.
For real, lane splitting should be legal across the entire United States.
I think so, too. Yeah.
At least at stoplights. Like, let us get in between the cars. Because I don't have, like, a whole bunch of friends. But I've had three friends, like, personal friends, not, like, Instagram friends. Three personal friends get hit just sitting at a stoplight.
Yeah.
And, like, to the point where their bike was totaled. Like, not just, like, a tap. Like, they fucking smoked them.
Yep.
That's fucked up.
Yeah, I gotta say, like, coming down from Canada, where I'm from, there's a lot of routes that I gotta go through. And I blast past people. It's not lane splitting, but once that dotted yellow line comes, you gotta take them over. Because motherfuckers around here, they'll be going 25 miles an hour in a fucking 45. They're just like leaf peeping, looking at the fucking whatever. And I'm just like, yay. And you just gun it, dude. And that's wicked fun.
Leaf peeping.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that is like the kryptonite of anybody that lives in New England.
Oh, my God.
As soon as fall time comes, there's people from all over the country that just drive 20 miles an hour to look at fucking leaves that are dying.
Yeah.
You're looking at death. You fucking weird people.
So macabre. Yeah, dude. It is beautiful, though. For about two weeks.
It's a beautiful death.
Yeah.
That's how you describe it. It's a beautiful death.
Well, it's like the last... It kind of indicates the beginning of winter, where everything's just dead and gold. So you just get out and you're like oh, it's still soul. Yeah, it's still flannel hoodie season, and you get out on your bike and you're like, this is the last time I'll be outside and be happy for another 6 months.
Yeah. We got some good days this past winter. We were able to go out in like January a few times.
Oh, no shit. Yeah.
Oh, New England is like the new North Carolina.
Really?
The past 2 years, we've had like...
Dude, like the last 5 years, there's been like no fucking snow.
Like, we get like one or two snowstorms a year now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm good with that. I mean, except for not this past one, but the winter before, it like randomly was negative 40 degrees.
Oh, that
which
was...
is fucking so uncalled for and fucked up.
Yeah, that was uncalled that for.
That shit fucking pissed me off. But other than that, I love New England weather right now. I'm all about global fucking warming.
Yeah.
Oh, right? Yeah. I fucked up as that is, I'm all about it. Because I like these 100-degree fucking summer days.
Oh, yeah.
I like winter to be zero snow. I can deal with 40 degrees, 35 degrees all winter. I'm fine with that. Even 20 degrees, I'm fine with it. Mm-hmm. But I fucking hate snow. I don't want to go shovel. I don't want to do any of that shit.
This summer has been fucking amazing. There's like no rain. It's hotter than hell. Dude, I'm standing outside. I got two cans of Aquanet. I'm trying to burn a fucking hole in the ozone layer right above my house.
Bring that
Aquanet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My mom buys that shit by the case.
Oh, my God.
I love the Aquanet.
Damn.
Oh, all right. Fuck.
All right.
Come on, before, look, I want to get a little bit more information on the sporty because we glazed over that.
Oh, okay, yeah.
This being your first build.
Mm-hmm.
I remember we talked about this before you started. What was the other one you were considering doing? The pan?
No, there was a...
Or shovel?
Big Twin Evo.
Oh, Big Twin.
Oh, that's what it was. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think it was a 91, actually.
I think you reached out to us and we were like, Sportster.
Yeah. We had a vote on this, on this show.
Mm-hmm.
And, we were very much so Team Sportster.
Yeah.
I'm glad I went with the Sportster. I feel like you such guys said bike. It, but it's like a rite of passage, you know? And then I talked to so many people at Fuel, and they're like, yeah, I think I'm going to do a Sporty next. And I felt so solidified in my decision.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the cool thing is about a Sportster is, like, as long as you don't build the 4-speed like I did.
Oh, yeah.
Like, Rhino's, his Sporty chop, this motherfucker would just crank down the highway at 75 miles an hour forever.
Oh, yeah.
Dang.
And be fine. Never broke. The thing always rode fucking whenever he wanted to ride.
Yeah.
Like, you cannot ask any more out of a bike than a Sportster. And it's like riding a BMX bike.
Mm-hmm.
You can throw that bitch around.
Yep.
Nice and light.
It's fine if you just drop it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, so that's another reason I did that patina look, because I'm just like, well, as a Sportster, so if I drop it in the driveway, it's not like a big deal. Yeah. Our driveway is
You don't have to worry about that, yeah. Getting a rock, you know. Imagine taking your bike out and it gets dirty and you're like bummed out. That would suck.
I know. I'm like, no, I don't ever think I'll wash the bike, honestly. Yeah. Like, maybe just dust off the Dragon and Tiger, but...
There you go.
I think it's crazy.
I'll tell you, though, when you did that paint job, I talked to so many people about, like, people brought it up to me. And were like, dude, have you seen this Sporty? And, like, would show me, and I'm like, yeah, I know that chick.
Oh, my God.
That fucking... Yeah, that paint is... When it's amazing. When that came out, I was like, dude, this thing is fucking sick.
Thank you.
That is that's one of the coolest paint jobs I've seen this year, I think.
Oh, 100%.
That's so
for real.
Rad.
That thing is
Thank
super
so
fucking
much.
Rad.
Yeah.
Huh?
I'm going to do a hand painted tank. I'm going to do like something similar, I think, because like,
yeah.
It just like the aesthetic of it is so cool. And actually doing, I actually enjoy painting and stuff. Like, I come from like an art background. I used to do a lot of, you know, like, actual canvas
everything.
Painting and all that shit.
He did everything.
Oh, yeah. But
this guy was a movie director before. It's so weird. Anything that we ever talk about, Rhino, like, has, like, a fucking master's in it. It's fucking insane.
Yeah, I used to be a private detective.
I'm like, hey, you want to get on the podcast with me and be a co-host? And he's like, yeah, I know everything about it, actually.
My spare time, sure. Damn.
Yeah, he's a master at everything.
It's crazy. Very cool.
Oh, one thing I didn't catch is, did you do forwards or mids on that, baby?
I just kept the mids.
The mids, okay.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, good choice.
I initially really wanted to add one of the Kickstart kits where I would have to put the forward controls on.
Mm-hmm.
But I really like the mids because it reminds me of the Japanese chop scene.
Mm-hmm.
You know how they sit so tight and they're like,
yeah.
Knees are above? Oh my God, that, no one does it like them. It's so fucking sick. So yeah, I'm just keeping the mids. I like it a lot.
Yeah, when I switched from forwards to mids on my Sportster, and I'm so pissed that I waited 4 years to do it.
Yeah, same.
The mids are just this, like, yeah, it's just fucking perfect.
Yeah,
it is, yeah.
It's so perfect.
Yeah,
it was like night and day. Yeah,
yeah.
I was like, I'm never going back to forwards after that.
Oh, really?
Well, like, the mids on the Sportster, I don't know what it is. It sits perfect for me, you know? Like,
yeah.
On the shovel, I have the mids, and it's not, like, the right placement, you know? Like, with the spit, where they land on the Sportster, for me, it's just, like, for my body type, which is the absolute apex of male physical condition, as you can all tell. It just fucking, it's comfortable, you know? And there's plenty of places, like, you can stretch your leg out on the same peg, you know? Like, you can get it, you know, if you're riding and you're going through some fucking frost heaves or some fucking, like, twisties, you can get up on it. And then if you're just cruising, just throw your fucking legs out. It's, like, perfect for, I guess, I don't have long lady dancer legs, but they get me around. But you could definitely, like, just stretch out and get some circulation down there.
Yeah. I've been kind of looking for a piece to add to the front. Like, it's sort of like a crash bar. Chicken has all kinds of crazy fucking shit on his chops. Like, he has a horse. I don't know what they're called, but whatever you put on a horse. He has that on the front of one of his rat rods. So I'm looking for a good piece, but I haven't found it yet.
I had some, where the original, like, on my Sportster, where the original forwards were mounted, I put some, like, essentially highway pegs that I just screwed in.
Oh, okay.
And that was super nice to just be able to, like, kick it out and put it up. But how tall are you?
I'm 5'5".
5'5". Okay, so, okay.
Yeah.
Fuck, we're almost the same height.
Really?
Man. I'm only 5'7".
With my Doc Martens, I'm 5'7". I have to wear those when I'm on the panhead because I can't reach anything unless I wear those.
Oh, no shit. 5'5", that's pretty little.
Yeah. That panhead, it has like 16-inch apes and stuff. I look like a fucking starfish going down the road. It's not too comfortable for me. So I just kind of ride on the back on that, mostly. That's primarily Jacob's.
No shit. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's the Sportster, especially, you know, with mids being 5'5", I think that's perfect. Anything longer than that, I mean, dude, the forwards are... You'd need to put wooden blocks on the fucking pedals, you know?
Yeah. I like
Yeah, even being 5'7", I did not like the forwards.
Sometimes if you're feeling real cool, getting a video, put your foot up on the primary, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's how I used to ride when I had forwards.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Same. Yeah. You have to, you know, because your legs, like, you need a different position. It's nice to have different positions, you know, to be able to, like, move your legs in different places. Throwing it up on the primaries. Elite though on a Sportster, it's super easy.
Yeah. Very cool.
Yep. All right, guys, we have to shout out some of those motherfuckers that make this show possible.
Up first, we got Dan at No Luck Paintworks. Hands down, I don't care what you say, don't at me. Hands down, best painter on the East Coast. I'm going to say it right now. I don't care if you like it or not. Kid's fucking beast. He'll never say any of this. Absolute beast. He always brings his craft to the next level on every goddamn paint job. Always pushing himself to be better, and I fucking love it. So if you want to bring your build to the next level, hit up Dan at No Luck Paintworks. Get on that winter list, and you won't fucking regret it. Next, we got Deadbeat Customs, the creator of the Deadbeat Retreat, where all low lives go to die. It's the official fucking end of summer show for the Low Life fucking podcast. We've been hitting this since the very beginning. We love Steve. He loves us. He supported us through getting canceled from Spotify. Fuck Spotify. You know what I'm saying?
He's a real one.
We're still on Spotify.
He's a real one.
Steve's a real one. He's a gangster from way back. Steve has a little bit of everything for everyone. You can get chopper parts, Dynabro parts, performance bagger parts, luggage, vest, helmets, sunglasses, whatever the fuck you need at deadbeatcustoms.com. Use code LOWLIFE at checkout.
Next, we got Stay Stronko, the creator of the best goddamn hot sauce in the entire world, the collab E of the chopper sauce. This shit is fucking hot. It is delicioso. Get the trio. Get the three-pack. Get the shit, the shits, and the chopper sauce. Support our fucking homie, John Luke, his beautiful soul, and his white baby Jesus pants. We love him so much. Go support him at staystrongco.org.
Oh, did you? He was at Fuel Cleveland. Did you see him?
I did. Yeah, I was really tell Jacob, and I was like, this isn't just a hot sauce. This is like a glaze and a dipping sauce.
She's got the whole ad read.
Yep.
Up next, we got Lowbrow Customs. Everything you need for the road ahead. The only website where you can build an entire chopper in one place. From engine frames, the gas tanks, sissy bars, handlebars, whatever you need, they have it. They have all your fab parts. You don't have a lathe? That's fine. They got bungs. They got leather washers. They have specialty tools for those old shovel heads. Go shop at lowbrowcustoms.com and help us repay the favor to Tyler for supporting everything chopper.
Next up, we got Whee Motor Co. That's HUI Motor Co. Whee Wrench, Whee Ride, Whee Motor Co. Gocho, my neighbor up in Canada, he's got gear for riders so they can still afford to ride, like his sub $300 club style vest with the diamond stitching, and don't you forget, place for your sunglasses. You don't want to get that 60 weight on your fucking lenses, bro ham. He also got shirts, hats, hoodies, and other goodies like his Kevlar lined flannels. Go pick them up. Go to HUIMotorCo.com. Next up, we got our boy Matt, Burnt Up Wood Burning. Photo realistic wood burning designs from choppers and hot rods to pets and hot broads. Get your old lady's titties done. Immortalize your man's wang. Hanging up in your foyer. Hanging up in your parlor. I don't know what kind of fucking floor plan you got, but Matt is
your
man.
That's what I'm getting
man.
You for Christmas.
I'll hang it up in my foyer, dude. People walk in and be like, is that Loctite's dick? And I'll be like, yeah, it was a gift. Got it for Christmas.
It's just on a pine cone.
But, dude, Matt's the fucking man. Matt and his boy, they're coming for the ride, bro. They're coming up from Connecticut, and they're meeting in New Hampshire. They're going to be meeting at my place. We're going to be kicking it off. We're going to the DBR. We're all going to ride together. Super stoked on that. Next up, we got Silver City Co., his boy Austin, now offering welding, fabrication, small maintenance out of Meriden, Connecticut. This is a father and son team. I mean, this is a dynamic duo. How fucking cool is that? They're both riding up. They go, you know what? Yeah, maybe it would be quicker if we just went right to New York, being from Connecticut. But they're like, no, it's about the experience. They're going to be riding out with us. It's fucking beautiful, dude. He does cars, goals, bikes, all sorts of fucked up shit. So stoked that they're making out, number one, to Deadbeat, and number two, that they're going to be riding with us. These boys are about it. Last on my list, but certainly not least, welcome to Jamrock, the original bad boy. This guy, don't even fuck with him. Don't even fuck with him. Chris from Oxford Co. Choppers. I'm not even going to spoil it. I talked to him the other day. This guy has so much huge shit in the works. We're going to have to do another episode with him. He has some shit going down. This boy's about to blow the fuck up like a goddamn volcano. He does handlebars, hardtails, hard parts for hard men. The home of the $900 hardtail installed, TIG welded in-house, USA-made steel, cast axle place. He let me in on some secrets. Guys, follow Oxford Co. Choppers. He's going to be a household name within the next year. Guaranteed. You heard it here first, folks. This boy is about it. Next, we got my boy, Lock Chops, motherfucking Chop Shop.
Could be located in Epic, New Hampshire, the home of the three governors, the motherfucking center of the universe. For all your pinstriping needs, hit me up. Whether you want some custom garage signage, you want your bike pinstripe, you want me to pinstripe your baby, I don't care. Enamel's safe for everything. Hit me up, Loctite Shop Shop.
Oh, no, that's true.
Now, you can use enamel on body. It's fine. I already checked.
Pregnant women?
I don't know how well it comes
pregnant
off.
Pregnant women and babies?
Yeah, they don't use lead anymore, so it's pretty safe. Hit me up, Loctite Shop Shop on Instagram, or email me, Loctite at lowlifechopperpodcast.com.
Last and but not least,
Angel Claw Pinstriping. Give yourself a plug. Let the people know.
Yeah, hit me up. You guys want a tank painted, canvas, whatever. Kind of getting into the dark, vintage, like fantasy stuff. Anyone wants a wizard, let me know. I'll make it happen for you.
So you'll do the hand painted tank stuff too?
Yeah.
That's fucking awesome.
Yeah, send me your tank, a fender, whatever. Whatever you want. I'll make it come true. Also revamping my posters a little bit. Having a little bit more fun with that. Maybe a little bit more groovy. Maybe a little bit more silly. So you need a poster for your garage, let me know.
Fuck Dave.
Cosign from the Low Life Podcast. Hit her up.
We love silly. Last but not least.
And last but not least.
This show. This show. The Low Life Podcast. We drop in the chapa. Hopefully by this Friday, I'll get all that shit sorted out. The new URL has been bought and paid for. The Low Life Podcast. The at the Low Life Podcast on Instagram. At the Low Life Podcast on YouTube. Go to the lowlifepodcast.com. We're going to have everything linked for all our shops and socials. And our new email addresses. Rhino. Actually, I'll post this on Friday because I don't know what it's going to be yet. I think we should have a central one that we can both have access to. So people can send us whatever you want. Tell us what's steaming your beans. Tell us what topics you want to hear. Tell us what's pissing you off. Tell us what's making you happy.
What guests you want to hear.
What guests you want to get on. Your boy has some fucking cool shit going on. Let us know. We're going to do it through email. Do it through the through IG. Tell us what you want to hear. And I'll make some silly fucking graphics and music to go along with it. Because that's what we're about. We're about having fun now. We're just having fun.
Love it. Great episode. Hey, I've been looking forward to this episode for a long time. I wish we dove into the pain a little bit more. But that just leaves us room to do another episode.
That's right.
I would like to just do a strictly paint episode, if you're down for that.
Oh, yeah.
And also...
A chicken episode.
A chicken episode.
Oh, I'm going to tell Chicken. He'll be really excited.
We need
about
the chicken.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to hear all the stories.
Oh, he will.
But huge thanks, seriously. This has been an episode I've been looking forward to. I cannot wait to do the next one. Strictly all paint. Killer job on the Sforcer. I'm not kidding.
Yeah, definitely.
Just because you're on this episode, that is legit one of my favorite paint jobs of 2024. You absolutely crushed it.
That's so fucking and,
thanks for coming on. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for having me. I just feel really over the moon about it. So, thank you.
Yeah, no, we're lucky to have you. And it's always great to have people on the show that actually listen to the show, because most of the people we have on the show, they're like, who are you guys? Why do you want us on the show?
Oh my
and I'm
God,
like, hey,
no.
Fuck you. I'm just kidding. But hey, we're going to have a little after hours questionnaire, ooh, maybe for the laddies. But we're going to leave you freeloaders. You guys get this fucking shit for free every week, and you don't even donate. You don't even buy us a slice, you scumbag pieces of shit.
Ew.
We'll see you next week. That's how we doing on the Low Life Podcast.